Wow, look at this. What a great turnout. What an amazing turnout. Hey, everybody. My name is Mick Lubinskas. I'm the co-founder of Climate Salad. I'm really passionate about helping climate tech companies grow and solve environmental sustainability problems. And that's what we're here for tonight. I'd like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of the land on which we meet, the Turrbal and Jagera people. I pay my respects to elders and leaders, past, present and emerging, and for all of our First Nation friends joining us here tonight. I'd also like to stop now and ask for Clinton to come up and say a few words. He's been kicking ass, literally. So, also from Sober, great support, Clinton, if you would say a few words about.
Gabba gabba yada malia, nyanagia nungu, yagara turubu, yalagima wu naraga, yalagia nama, gadia Clinton, nai gomeroi. So, in the language of my people, the Gamilaroi people, I'd also like to acknowledge the traditional custodians of this place, being Yagara and Turrbal people. And I just wanted to quickly explain a little bit about that process, because I think it's important that people see it more than just a tick-the-box exercise. We undertake that acknowledgement because we're acknowledging that somebody over a long period of time have spent a lot of time, a lot of energy, a lot of purpose into looking after and protecting place. And that if we're all fortunate enough to be here at this time, right here, right now, sharing this place, we actually hold shared responsibility to place. So that acknowledgement has always been about us recognizing that when I'm sharing that space, I hold role and responsibility to ensuring that I leave it in as much a positive state, if not more, when I leave as I found it. So we all share that responsibility tonight because we've all been brought together through this awesome event to share this country, to share this piece of country. And we all share a responsibility to each other within that as well, to look out for each other throughout the night as well. So Gabaninda, thank you, and enjoy the evening.
Seems right that a group of people who were able to live sustainably for 60,000 years have a lot to teach us. So absolutely. So thank you, Clint. I really, really appreciate that. We're going to start with the welcome from Wayne Gerard. We were hoping he was going to be here tonight, but we do get a quick video. So,
g'day everyone, it's Wayne Gerard, Queensland's Chief Entrepreneur. Welcome to the precinct and welcome to our 2022 Climate Showcase. We've got so many exciting things happening here tonight, and I'm really great that you've taken the time to come and join us on this really important journey and conversation around how do we as Queensland showcase the amazing innovation that we're doing in climate and environmental tech. The climate and the environment are two of the most important aspects of what makes Queensland distinct and unique. And we are so well placed as a state, as an economy, and as a society to leverage our natural strengths, to partner with local innovators, local entrepreneurs, local researchers to solve some of the world's most pressing climate challenges. In the next 10 years, as we lead up to Brisbane 2032, we want to unpack all of the opportunities that we have as a state to position Queensland to deliver the world's first climate positive games. What an amazing opportunity over the next 10 years to think about how are we going to help solve the climate challenges that we're facing globally. Queensland is really well equipped to become a climate tech powerhouse, and we can only do that by working together. By working together, we can look at some of the big climate challenges, the big climate opportunities, the big environmental opportunities that we have here in Queensland. When we think about the reef, or we think about the outback, or we think about natural disasters, or we think about how do we make an impact on the climate by changing the way we do waste or waste to energy, by thinking about how do we recycle water. There are so many different aspects of climate and climate tech that we can apply here in Queensland that will really be transformational for our society, for our economy, and for our environment. So thanks for coming today. I hope the conversation is really, really valuable. I hope you make amazing relationships. Take the time to introduce yourself to people you don't know. And remember that one of the things that makes our innovation ecosystem really unique, really special, is our value of give before you get. It's that idea that we walk into any meeting, any conversation. We walk up to a person here today and we think about how can we help them? Who can we connect them to? How can we help them solve a problem? How can we help them get, you know, get ideas or test an idea? It's really about how can we collaborate together to solve Queensland and the world's most important climate challenges. Have a great night.
And I'm now going to ask Sarah to come up and say a few words. Sarah, thank you.
Thanks. So I think Wayne did that very well. Everybody, I'm Sarah Smith, the Chief of Staff for Wayne, and a very busy office. I just wanted to say that we're super proud to be a collaborative partner for this event. I'm super impressed at how packed we are, and I'm really sorry to everyone that doesn't have a seat. For those who know me know I'm super competitive, and yes, we have more people than the Sydney Climate Tech Showcase. We have more people than the Melbourne Tech Showcase. Just saying. So as Wayne said, he is super passionate about this space. He believes that climate tech for good that helps us as a species to get into sync with the environment is where it's at. To reduce our carbon footprint, to increase our biodiversity, and to improve our food and water safety. So in Queensland, we're thinking about how we build deep expertise and a global brand in the climate tech space. And it's awesome that you're all here on that journey with us. So we really need to be thoughtful, strategic, and considered about our industry plan for climate tech, how it ties in with our regional hubs, how we link in with the chief scientist and the newly jointly funded, it's a very long name, Partner Up Regional Science Network. So there's people in the regions focused on these initiatives. And obviously, as Wayne said, it's really critical that we get this right in the lead up to the 2032 Olympic and Paralympic Games. Now, I do want to do a shout out for those who follow us on social, which we hope is all of you, and we'll get a massive boost after tonight, just saying. So today we announced the Low Carbon Accelerator Program. So I'm assuming that there's lots of you in the audience that may be interested in applying for that. Phil's going to give us a bit of a rundown on it a bit later. The great thing about it is there's money attached, so you learn lots, and then you've hopefully got some cash at the end if you partner with industry around your solution. So we'll find out more about that, but have a look. And I'm also going to do a really quick shameless plug. In October, we have a huge innovation festival happening, which is called Something Fest, and there's a number of partners joining together, and that runs from the 23rd to the 28th of October. But definitely check out the website and get involved in that event, because it'll be bringing everyone together like this in some bigger venues. Thanks. Enjoy the day.
Thanks, Sarah. For those who do use social media like MySpace and others like me, hashtag, did I miss something? MySpace, not around. Queensland Climate Tech, that'd be great to get this going. That'd be fantastic. Huge thanks to you to our partners, especially, of course, the Office of Queensland Chief Entrepreneur for showing the massive support for doing this. They were just straight away, they were like, yes, let's do it. Let's get a group of people together. Let's really energise and activate this climate tech ecosystem in Australia. They've been invaluable and been wonderful partners here today in the chaos of putting together this big event. So a big thanks to their team, especially Sandy and everybody, for making this really possible. So thank you so much. And our other partners as well who've really made Climate Salad possible. Wallamai Investable, AWS, Stefan's here from AWS. Minter Ellison, Future Super, Mandalay, massive support for this weekend, this week's activities. KPMG, Main Sequence, Pollination, and Upshore, who we again got some good representatives here today. So, huge thank you to them who are actually helping us build this new climate tech ecosystem here in Australia. Our supporters as well, a number of people also in the room here, the team from Sober, thank you so much. Fable, you'll be getting some, if you miss out on the mass amounts of food, there is more food coming. But because we don't want any waste, you've got to stay here till it's all, no one's leaving till it's all gone. Luckily, there's non-alcoholic drinks we can have, so Sober and Heaps Normal, Hawks Lager, and Pacamama as well. So thank you again to all of your supporters. The Climate Salad team for making this happen, a huge thank you to, we've got Charlotte and Olivia here. Round of applause for the amazing team. This team does a lot with very little to actually make this climate tech industry happen, and they work really, really hard. They're big believers in what we can do, and exactly what Wayne and Sarah are talking about, this opportunity for Australia. Really, really passionate team, so thank you to them. What is Climate Salad? I heard somebody at the front door asking that today. What is Climate Salad? And I was trying to listen into the response. It started as a blog, to be frankly, about 12 months ago, and it has snowballed wonderfully into this incredible thing. We just say Climate Salad is we're a group of people who are supporting climate tech companies from Australia build global solutions to climate environmental problems, and we do it by giving them tools, running programs, and building a community. And by being here today, you've already joined. You're a part of that today. You're just a part of that community, helping to make this industry grow. Our mission, we want to help 1,000 climate tech companies by 2030, with at least 10 of them being global successes. 10 million tonnes of GHG equivalent, 1 million customers, or $1 billion valuation. Now, that's not saying 990 failures. We just know that some of you are going to be on long journeys to global success. So we want to help a lot of people and make sure we have some really deep impact. And hopefully that continues onward. Really importantly, it's not 2050. Humans have a tendency to cram things, so like wait till 2049 and just go really hard. The time to cram is now. The time to cram is absolutely now. We've got to be active right now. So that's our mission. For founders, we offer a lot of community support, these tools. We have workshops. We do lots of mentoring. We also have a lot of activities coming up, which we'll talk about. So that's our focus, is helping those climate tech entrepreneurs. You know, those founders and the teams building this technology are the core people. We don't want to lose sight. We're not the important people in the room. They're the ones actually putting the risk and building it. And for all of our partners, we want to bring them together and facilitate their interactions with this new community. What is this community? How do I participate? How do I help? And we're doing that across universities, governments, community groups, and corporates as well. So. Getting going. Oh my goodness. So I keep thinking Charlotte's repeating these logos. And I'm sure if you can find one, let me know. But these are our members. And again, last year, like almost exactly a year ago, there was 15 climate tech companies. And I said, there's too many to handle. 15's a lot. I'm going to have to put you in a Slack group. So I put them in a Slack group. And that's grown and grown and grown to 225 climate tech companies in Australia. And I think we've got less than 20% of them. I think there's a lot of them out there in unis and labs out there actually getting customers, but an incredible array of people who are committed to solving enormous climate problems. And that gives me a lot of hope. I'm a dad of three kids, and my whole reason of doing this is because exactly what Clinton talked about is leaving this place better than we found it. And I don't believe that's going to happen unless people in this room activated right now with support and passion to go and solve those things. And that gives me some hope. That's what we talk about, is turning anxiety into hope and turning apathy into action. So we want to say, don't just talk about the possibilities of climate tech. Have a look at them. They're flood map. They're in this building. They're doing amazing things. Whether it's reduction of emissions, removal, climate impact, mitigation and adaptation, or whether it's about biodiversity improvement, there's lots of things we can do. And exactly as Wayne and Sarah said, Australia is and Queensland very, very well positioned to actually have a significant impact on this globally. And I think it is our opportunity. Some say it's a responsibility. I think I'd like to say we want to be proactive. We want to choose to do it. We want to choose to step forward and go and solve these problems, and all these people are. So please put your hand up if you represent one of the companies here in this on the room there. So a round of applause for all the people doing that hard work. So thank you so much. It does take a village to build these companies. It's really hard. I've been doing it for a very long time, despite myself being so young. It does take a village to build it. We need lawyers, we need accountants, we need consultants, we need researchers, we need government, universities, corporates. Everyone needs to participate. And this is the ecosystem coming together to support it. And we really, really appreciate all the help as well. We recently did a study, and this Olivia here did the vast majority of this work. We wanted to really understand these companies. So we did a quick study, not a quick study, sorry, Olivia, it felt quick to me. We did a really long, slow, painful study of 171 companies because we wanted to understand more about them because it is really complex and diverse, and it is. We wanted to make sure we understood more about it so we can actually help groups like here in Queensland understand what the opportunities are and where the gaps might be. Some really quick flick-throughs here. Quite young companies, incredible diversity. 39.7% with a female founder. That's the largest I've ever worked with in my long history of startups. There's already 4,000 jobs being created and already significant amounts of greenhouse gases removed from the environment. And many of them have significant revenues. So these are not crazy startups with wild ideas. We've got real companies like Michael at Fable, the amazing team at Fable, the real scale. And they've raised $1.4 billion already, just these 171 companies. Incredible progress so far. Very, very exciting. What is their ambition? Okay, these are, they're only just on the path. So they want to hire 2,000 more people, take nearly 1,000 gigatons of greenhouse gases out of the environment, and they actually want to looking at significant growth over the next 12 months. And capital raising, they've already raised 1.4. They're pretty ambitious. They want another 1.3. And that's within the next 12 months versus that's totally raised as well. Really key for us is Australia is a very big country, but it's a small market. So critical to Climate Salad is that they've got global ambitions. So half of the capital has been international capital. That's incredible. Again, I've never seen those numbers in an Australian sector over the many, many years. So a lot of them already have international operations, and many of them are actually opening within the next 12 months. We got a little bit of a breakdown, and when I say me, I mean Olivia, doing all the hard work. Queensland breakdown. So we have 22 companies out of the 171 from Queensland. Let's double, triple, quadruple that over the next year. And here is a bit of a view of their sectors. So again, some really obvious ones we mentioned already in terms of agri-food, resources, circular economy, data and finance, and opportunities definitely within storage and mobility, but a really good spread. And you read those sectors and you realise how big and broad the climate problem is. Out of the 22, they raised $39 million, created a lot of jobs and creating more jobs, and 50% of them are raising capital. I know a number of them in the room tonight. I'm sure they're going to meet some really good people. And the other thing we want to make sure is that they're not just single-minded, myopic. We want to make sure they're all caring about all the SDGs and make sure we're building companies for total sustainability. Something we did last year as a start of that understanding was the Climate Tech 100. We're going to be doing that again in the next couple of months, so we want to get participation around that. This is not about who's the best. It's about representation. We want to set representation across the sectors and across different stages, and we're going to be running that again with Hole and IQ, who are our data partners. Something else to tell you about is we're actually taking a bunch of Australian companies on the first Climate Tech mission. So as we mentioned, going international is critical. So in October this year, we're taking a number of companies to Verge. There's going to be about 4,000 people coming from around the world, congregating, talking about climate tech. And we want to go to the US market with a focus on customers. Again, we know if we build a great team and a good product, we go get customers, then the capital will follow. And that's our big focus of market entry there. So if you're interested in that, get in touch with us after this. You can also, hopefully, if my tech's working with the QR code, we charge an exorbitant $100 a year to be a part of the climate tech community. And the goal of that is to basically have a really strong group of people who want to collaborate and support each other building out this industry. So please, love to have you along. We also do a lot more partnerships. Just to quickly mention, we run programs, showcases like this, and we do talks and workshops to, again, help the rest of Australia understand this climate tech opportunity. And approach it with hope and action. Okay, that's my rant over. Thank you for letting me have the stage and to talk to you about it. Thanks firstly for turning up. I think when we first started speaking to Sarah and the team about this a few months ago, it was like, you know what, let's do this. Let's try to get at least 100 good people in the room. And then very quickly we went past that and we've gone way past that, and it's definitely the biggest climate tech showcase we've ever held. And that's a testament to the great community we have here in Queensland. I'm sorry to say, from Sydney, and we've always been massively impressed by the collaboration and support that the Queensland community has, of both in terms of regional and diversity, and coming together to actually really work together to solve some of these big problems. So kudos to you, all of you, being here today. We have brought together a couple of investors, and because we focus again on the climate tech entrepreneurs and their companies, we're asking these investors to pitch to you. So this is a bit of the reverse pitch. Charlotte's brilliant idea. So what I'm going to do, we're going to run a panel, but just before we do the panel, I'm going to get them one by one to give themselves a quick introduction. And what we want to talk about, something really particularly important to the team here in Queensland, is diversity and inclusion. And we've already touched on it a little bit. We know we're doing pretty well with that, but we know we've got to keep investing in it. So we want to hear from some of these investors about, you know, who are they, but also what's important to them and how do they think about diversity and inclusion, particularly with climate tech. So I'm going to start. Beth, would you like to go first? Yeah, Beth from Pollination. Round of applause. Right.
So I'm Beth Keddy. I'm an executive director at Pollination. You'll hear when I do my pitch that diversity is really important to us in terms of ways of knowing and making the path to a transition to a net zero nature positive future. I will talk a little bit more about the diversity of backgrounds, cultures and experience that we've brought together to enable that in terms of making the pathway. First Nations is also really important to us. Many people don't know that we have a foundation which is focused on putting humanity at the heart of climate solutions. And it's really, really critical, the pace we need to move in this transition, that we do so in a just and socially equitable way. Thanks.
Thank you. Okay, Tom, you're up next.
Okay, thanks. Firstly, great to see so many people here tonight. I'm Tom Klein, the co-head of climate tech at Investable. Investable is an early stage manager, and we've invested in over 100 businesses to date. And, you know, climate tech is now the focus of our current fund. And really, we think it, you know, we're super excited about the space and so amazed with all the number of people here today, because, you know, there are certain times when, you know, I watch the news, I get a little depressed or despondent thinking about the world that my kids might grow up in. But really get excited when I talk to founders and look at the new technologies out there. So thanks, Mick, for putting this on.
Thanks, Tom. And last, we have Phil from Mendeley. Thank you, Phil.
Woo, okay. Thank you. Thank you, Mick and Charlotte, for putting this amazing event together. Can we get a big round of applause so that I can feel good about standing here, but also so we acknowledge the hard work that's been done by the team. So we're probably the newest kid on the block when it comes to venture in Queensland. So Mendeley Venture Partners is an early stage venture capital fund or firm focused on investing in agri-food technologies. We have across the team managed four funds. This is the fourth fund we've managed across the team. And we've been an active participant within the Queensland ecosystem. In fact, the Australian ecosystem and even ASEAN quite extensively over the last few years. We see ourselves as early stage startup and commercialization experts. We've been innovation consultants, founders, investors. We've worked across university. We've worked across government and private sector. And so part of the DNA of, or a big part of the DNA of Mendeley is being partnering with our founders on that sort of seed to Series A stage and going in the trenches with them and really seeing that partnership as we have been there before, we have been founders before, we know exactly what it looks like. We also know that for a lot of these businesses to be successful, we need to surround them with an ecosystem of support. So we also see ourselves as ecosystem builders, developers across Queensland, Australia, and again, ASEAN. So we have just recently celebrated the first close of our fund at about $20 million, which means that we're actively looking at opportunities to invest at the moment while we continue to raise the fund. So if you are doing anything in agri-food tech across Australia, come and find us and come and talk to us. We don't talk ourselves as a climate tech investor, but obviously climate and sustainability is important in everything we do. And I think we can all acknowledge that in agri-food systems, agri-food and agri-food tech, sustainability and future opportunities are one and the same. So we really see that as a big part of what we do. And thank you again for allowing us to be part of this event. Cheers.
Woo, thank you. And last but not least, I'm Christy Devlin from Waldemar Capital. Christy.
Thank you. Hey, everyone. I'm Christine Devlin. I'm an associate director at Waldemar Capital. We are also, unfortunately, Sydney-based, but also in the U.S. as well, as you might tell from my accent.
Yeah,
oh, a little louder?
Yeah.
Okay.
Microphone to the chin.
You might regret that, yeah. Okay, so we're Sydney and U.S.-based is the punchline there. And we are specialist investors, and we're really proud of that. So I'm going to talk about two things, and I'll keep it brief. But essentially, I'm going to talk about our focus, and I'm going to talk about our mandate, because they're really, really important to who we are. So our focus is on companies that reduce GHG emissions across climate services, agri-technology, and energy transition. We focus on those because we want to be specialist investors, and because we want to be really highly specialized partners to the companies that we invest in. And so we think it is of the utmost importance that when you guys are raising money, you have someone on your side of the table that really understands the trials and tribulations that a company focused on climate goes through. And we've amassed a team that can do that. I won't go into that now, but happy to talk about it offline. And then the second is our mandate. And so something else that defines who Walmai is our flexibility, actually. So our power is in our flexibility. We are a firm, actually. And so what that means is that our capital allocation, the duration of capital, the size of the check, all of that is incredibly flexible, and it depends on the opportunity. We're not bound by a certain mandate or a certain industry or vertical. I imagine, you know, having been on the other side of the table before at a startup, it can be really, really frustrating to just get a closed door because you don't fit a specific niche. We have come together as a team understanding that niche and saying, understanding that friction rather from the capital raiser perspective. And we've said, great, we're gonna do away with that. We're gonna be a partner in growth. We're gonna see you through, as Mick said, the long journeys that a lot of you will be on. We understand that impact doesn't happen overnight. And we're incredibly excited to be here, to be a partner of Climate Salad and to meet you all.
Thank you. Christy, come grab a seat. Mic to the chin. Beth, I'd love to hear from you in terms of, we're going to start with a focus on diversity and inclusion. It's great to get that introduction and hear the differences.
I think I went the wrong way around.
No, it's okay. All good. We're agile and iterative here at Climate Salad. Absolutely. So, Beth, what we wanted to really dive into was just to really explore the topic of diversity and inclusion. We know we're not doing enough. We know everyone's got to invest in it. Can you tell us in terms of, you mentioned a few things in pollination, but we'd love to hear how you're addressing, how you're approaching it, and some of the activities you've got going.
Great. I might give a bit of an intro about pollination properly so that you know who we are as well. So pollination is both an advisory and an investment firm, and we are focused on accelerating a net zero nature positive future. So that's a little bit different. Most of my colleagues here are focused purely on investment. The reason that we have advisory as well is because we know that we have to make the path as well as fund the path, because the pace that we need to move affects every single sector of the economy, and it needs all players to lean into changing. So in our advisory business, it's worth knowing this, we've grown from 12 people to 160 globally in less than 3 years, and have recently been invested in by ANZ. We have, on the investment side, a joint venture with HSBC, Climate Asset Management, where we're already deploying a couple of $1 billion towards natural capital management, asset management. And we operate all along the spectrum, from early stage right through to transition infrastructure. So I guess in terms of diversity along the investment spectrum, we operate all the way along and like to partner with our companies on that journey. On the advisory side, the 160 people are not just consultants in advisory. They're people who've got lived real world experience across every sector. So we've basically got ex-ambassadors, we've got journalists, we've got data and tech gurus, we've got scientists, engineers, lawyers, policymakers, accountants, everyone that needs to come together to make this happen. And the reason that we do that is because when we connect the dots between all those different sectors and different parts of the economy, we create the new solutions and the new pathways to actually accelerate that transition. So I guess when you come to pollination, if you choose to, and we can invest in you, we partner with you not just to provide the capital, but also access to that global expertise so that you can accelerate your solution globally. We're also, as a result of having that advisory business, working with 150 large companies across multiple sectors globally, and we understand where the problems are, and we can connect your solutions to that scale and impact pathway. So what we look for in terms of diversity and inclusion is, you know, companies that actually bring together different backgrounds and expertise so they have a more robust solution that can scale across that, across the globe. And the First Nations piece, as I mentioned, is also a really important piece for us.
Thank you, Beth. Yes, absolutely. In terms of measurement, it was the biggest challenge that the entrepreneurs in the industry report, they said they were facing. And companies like Pollination, I think, go a long way in terms of the depth of experience and understanding of that problem and how to address it at scale. So, fantastic. Tom, I'll hear a bit of your thoughts around diversity and inclusion.
So absolutely, we think diversity is really important. We think about it in a couple of different ways. From a portfolio approach, we want diversity of types of technology, stage of technology, geographic region, absolutely gender and age. You know, in the last 12 months, we've looked at 1,300 climate tech opportunities. We've to date approved 12. You know, of those 12, I think 50% are female founders, so we're slightly above average, which is fantastic. From an age range, I think we've got founders in their 20s, 30s, 40s, and 50s. And then, you know, ethnicity is also a key focus for us. And, you know, when we have discussions with founders, we talk to them about how they're thinking about diversity within their own teams, because, you know, the data is absolutely in that if you have a more diverse team, you're much more likely to be successful. But we also recognize that some areas it's harder to be diverse. And so for those companies, we're talking to them about, well, what does your plan for diversity look like as you grow? But at the end of the day, for both the fund and these companies, diversity is, you know, an absolute imperative for us, because we think that's what's going to drive outcomes.
Fantastic. Phil?
Wow. Okay, fantastic. Love just hearing all about that, and do agree with everything that's been said so far in terms of the diversity of types of solutions that are required, where I see a firm like ours with probably a more narrow definition of what we can invest in, being able to partner, you know, a lot with firms like yours. Obviously, everything you've mentioned in terms of diversity of stages, gender, age, but also skills, backgrounds, ethnicity, and so on. I think that's all very, very important to any investor and anyone who's operating within the innovation ecosystem. With Mandalay, perhaps one of the things that I can add to the conversation is looking at diversity of geographical spread, and from an Australian perspective, and especially when you're looking at agri-food or even climate and sort of the intersect between the two, we're obviously seeing a lot of innovation happening not in the cities, right, in our regions. And so the regions are, on the one hand, the strength of the country. On the other hand, one of the biggest challenges as well, right? So how do we, as a small venture capital firm, how do we manage to work across such a wide geographical area? And it's hard for partners. You spread yourself really thin if you start to travel all over the country. We are committed to working in the regions, but the way we can enable that is by supporting and building vibrant ecosystems, both within the cities and in the regions. And big part of the work we're doing, multiple initiatives with the Queensland government, are exactly about that, about access and support and funding within the regions, which I think is really, really important, and fits our investment sort of sector quite well. So we work with government at various levels. We work with universities. We work with various research organizations, industry associations within the regions, local chambers of commerce. I've mentioned councils and whatnot. And think of some of those relationships as partnerships, so that they know who we are and what we can do within their own sort of sphere of knowledge and influence, so that when there are good things happening within the regions, and a lot of what we're seeing there is we don't know what we don't know, because we don't know what's happening sometimes you know, within the bubbles of our, you know, city ecosystems, right? Because they are bubbles in a way. So how do we make sure that, you know, there's a level of transparency, there is a path that's visible, there are partners across the entire country that can help good founders and innovators navigate their way to support and to funding. So big shout out to Advanced Queensland. We recently worked with them on an initiative with the AgTech and Logistics Hub in Toowoomba, and that was to deliver the inaugural AgTech, Queensland AgTech Accelerator, which was a really good experience of being active within, you know, within Queensland, within the region, and working with a lot of innovators there, and the relationships and partnerships that are built around those accelerators. And now, obviously, the low carbon accelerator we're running as well will be a great opportunity for us to do that.
Excellent. Christine,
would echo everything that's been said thus far. You know, the stats for diversity and inclusion across the investment industry are abysmal. I don't think I need to do a teach-in on that. Also, from a co-founder perspective, or sorry, a founder perspective, pretty abysmal. What I will say, you know, that's hasn't been said yet, is, you know, we also look for the ways in which the solutions that we invest serve the diverse stakeholders in a system. So that comes from experience. I was building an ag tech platform for 2 years prior to Wallamai, and that was working directly with smallholder farmers in Indonesia and India. And the focus of the solution was essentially how do we enact or catalyze behavioral change in a group of people that don't have additional capital to spend to get to that sort of impact, or don't speak the language or cannot read. And we've really folded that into our thesis here, you know, at Wallamai, where we say, okay, is the landowner, you know, in a natural capital solution, are they getting what they deserve? Is the person that might not be able to pay for this going to be served in some way? Have they been thought of? You know, although we're doing our best on recruiting and investing in companies with diverse boards and employees, you know, it's also really important to go down to the product level and to say, you know, who's actually being affected by this, and do they have a fair shot at changing their own system or using the technology?
Excellent. So I do really want to get to make sure we get to the pitches and also get to having more food and wonderful alcohol-free beer. But one thing I want to dig into is something that Chrissy just touched on. There is the balance and tension between impact and returns, and you all face it really regularly. And no one's here going, "Hey, I can blow $1 billion and let's just have impact." And no one's here saying, "I'm happy to make a mess of the environment or education or diversity in order to produce returns or impact." But how do you deal with the balance? It's up between the panel again, just a bit of a conversation around how do you deal with that tension? Back to you, Beth. Can you give us some views of how you deal with the tension between impact and returns?
Perhaps, you know, I think a good example is to say that if you do properly consider the product and its successful delivery, for example, landscape fire burning in Northern Australia, if you design that with social equity in mind, actually the value created is much larger than you would otherwise have created through exclusion. And so in most cases, you can actually prosecute both more equitable outcomes as well as returns which are acceptable. I think I actually work on the advisory side of the business more deeply than investment, so I don't have more specific examples around investments. But as I said, it is fundamentally at the heart of what we do is to consider the just transition.
The exciting part is that I think in climate investing is there is a much greater correlation than ever before about returns and impact. Like the businesses that can have the biggest emissions reduction or the businesses that can help accelerate it are the ones that are going to do the best. So I think it's now a lot less about that conversation. And the tailwinds for climate businesses are enormous, whether that's government support, corporates, consumers. Like, the landscape has totally changed, and I think that's really exciting. And I think there is going to be more money generated in this space than I think we've seen in, like, you know, than the internet ever created.
Phil, I want to take something there and I get you to answer something slightly different. In terms of that curve, Tom's saying we're not it's not philanthropy anymore, it's actually just business. Are we like right on the curve to mass adoption, or are we at the early adopter phase? Like, where do you think we are globally? This is a global problem, right? All the companies we're investing, we want to be global. We're in a bit of a bubble here, right? We all believe in it, we all know we're working in it. Where is the whole world in terms of that curve, do you think?
Whoa. All right. Big question on the spot.
40 seconds or less.
I think, so in general, you could say Australia is probably a few years behind the rest of the world in general, which is great because you probably have access to a crystal ball. If you look close enough, you can see what's happening, what mistakes have been made, what incredible opportunities have been, are happening across the world. But that said, and this is true for Queensland, it's true for Australia in general, we have a huge advantage to sort of leapfrog beyond a lot of the mistakes and you know, the things that have happened internationally. I know this is probably more intuitive than sort of backed as an answer, but I feel like while we're slightly behind, we can really make the most out of this opportunity and actually move much faster than a lot of places in the world. If I can just answer in terms of how we look at that from a Mandalay perspective as well, we don't call ourselves an impact investor. We do call ourselves a responsible investor. Impact is important to us because it is inherent to good business, I think. And also, we feel that so sustainability within the agri-food space is really important. And so, anyway, they're one, and as I said before, it's sort of one and the same. So for us, we need to see businesses that are thinking about the future of their industries very, very heavily. Agri-food is one of those places, one of those sectors. We have a huge advantage globally in terms of being able to use that as an Australian strength. And I guess the final thing for any kind of venture capital investor, ultimately for us, yes, we're investing in businesses. It's about the return, but it's the commercial success of those businesses that enables the impact we're after as well. So, you know, all of that is really important in how we look at the space.
And Christine, minor modification for you as well. Wallamai has a big presence in the US as well in Australia. It's a fairly new organization, but you're starting quite big. Can you talk about the advantages that gives to you, and like how does those two things work together in terms of the US and Australian teams?
Yeah, look, just like rising temperatures, climate change is happening everywhere. And although Australia has been on the front lines in a lot of ways, there's an immense amount of innovation that's being led out of the US. I would say, you know, with the landmark passing of the Inflation Reduction Bill and $400 billion going to directly to sort of, you know, climate impact, we feel incredibly well placed to take advantage of the, you know, financial returns that will be borne out in the next couple years. We believe wholeheartedly in that curve, and that we are on it, and we're on it rapidly, and we have to be on it now. And so that's why we are here today. And I think, you know, the other thing as well is hype Wallamai one more time, is, you know, the reason that we've structured ourselves the way we are is because we want to see companies through that growth phase. You know, I think there is still a gap in investing where it's like, we're a VC or we're late stage, and before you get to, you know, the TPGs of the world, you need patient capital to take you on that journey. And maybe it's introductions to corporates who are driving an immense amount of the demand and immense amount of the innovation dollars. Or maybe it's, you know, talking about go-to-market strategy so you can tap sort of a mass market. Whatever that is, you know, we really believe that these solutions that we're seeing are built for scale in mind, are no longer niche, the technology cost curve is coming down rapidly for a lot of the inputs. And that means that solutions are, built for everyone in a way that they weren't, say, 10, 20 years ago.
Okay, and quickly, quick fire back towards the line. Christine, to you, out of all the sectors of climate tech, which do you think is going to be the most interesting over the next 12 months? Ag, transport, energy, what's going to go through?
Yeah, okay, I will say I'm speaking on personally and not on behalf of the firm, but I think the really fascinating what's happening in carbon credit markets.
Okay.
And, you know, how the VCM will evolve, and also just the diversity of credits that are coming out and the ways people are monetizing good stewardship of land is just incredible.
Excellent. Phil, what's a big hot changing area?
Yeah, I was going to say agri-food.
Agri-food?
That makes that's a good answer, I think.
Yeah.
But otherwise, definitely now, given that we have a 10-year roadmap here, anything that has a much longer innovation cycles, so perhaps construction, innovation in construction, or even EV or whatnot, is really exciting at this stage in Queensland.
Yeah, Tom, what areas?
Yeah, I'll go with energy and sort of grid improvements, deployment, just given the amount of the way in which we need to decarbonize the sector, just there is so much to do, and therefore there is a huge opportunity there.
It's pretty old. Beth, exciting areas?
I'd have to agree with energy, but since you've already said it, I'm going to say that we're going to see enormous activity, not just in carbon markets, but in the shift from carbon to natural capital markets.
Yep.
Potentially the emergence of separate biodiversity markets, separate from carbon. They're currently called co-benefits. We don't think they're co-benefits. We think that they're benefits on their own. And the pace that we're seeing, I guess, with the the Task Force for Nature-Related Financial Disclosures driving this enormous realization across corporates of this huge risk and opportunity to bring nature and valuing nature into the economic system is just going to require data, tech, funding, scientific methods, solutions on a whole different scale and at pace. We did it for climate. It took a long time for climate, but, you know, but the playbook for climate is being used for nature, and it will be here rapidly, and especially in the next 12 months.
Sounds good. Plenty of opportunity for Queensland. Round of applause for the panelists here. Thank you. We talk about the village there, right? We know absolutely we need a diversity of investors with bring a whole lot of skills, different passion areas, and that's exactly what we were shown there. So you hadn't have enough field, you get a little bit more. So we're going to talk about the low carbon accelerator, then we're going to go into pitches.
All right, I'm sort of the last thing standing between you and the pitches. So let's do this quickly, but in a way that is exciting, because this is another good example of a real ecosystem win for Queensland, where we are now in a position to launch, and we've launched this afternoon, the inaugural low carbon accelerator based right here in Queensland. So the low carbon accelerator is a program catalyzed by the Department of Environment and Science and championed internally within government by the Office of the Chief Entrepreneur, who, as many of you would know, are an amazing sort of coordination body within government, making sure that these kind of initiatives can exist where government can actually collaborate with the innovation ecosystem in the search for innovation and solutions to big challenges for the state. So the low carbon accelerator itself is looking at working with startups, scale-ups, SMEs with innovative products and services that can support or contribute to the decarbonization of our Queensland economy. And there's obviously various sectors that are applicable. So, you know, take my agri-food hat off here. It's across all of sectors that are important to the state. Now, applications have opened today, and we will be open only for a month. So get on it. For everyone who's watching this afterwards on the live stream, have a look at lowcarbonqld.com. All of the details are there. It is delivered by us, the team at Innovation Architects. We deliver accelerators, incubators as a service across the country or across the state for sure. And we will. I'll quickly tell you what it's going to look like. So after you apply to the program, if you're shortlisted, you're invited to a two-day boot camp. Now, a two-day boot camp is on the one hand, an assessment for us, like where you're at from a business perspective, what's your potential impact that you can enable through your business, but we'll also get you sort of your foundations right by looking at your business, business diagnostics, pitching, connecting you to a lot of the climate tech and low carbon ecosystem, which is a really important part of such a program, is that you actually have a direct in to anyone within the low carbon ecosystem, be it government, investment, partners from across the state, and obviously industry. So once you pass the boot camp, you are invited potentially, if you're selected, as one of 10 companies to go through an intensive 6-week program to essentially get you ready to deliver a proof of concept program or a pilot program with a customer, which has to be an industry partner. And after those 6 weeks, everyone will have the opportunity to submit a business case to undertake such a program. You do get a little bit of funding as part of these 6 weeks to allow you to accelerate the progress to the business case. But essentially what we want afterwards is 5 funded proof of concept projects with a customer, with an industry partner. And that final stage of the program, the proof of concept program, will happen early in 2023. So if you want to know more, connect with us. We're here. I've got Tim here, who's part of our team. Mark might still be around, but there's also Heather, Sarah from the Chief Entrepreneur's Office. We can all talk to you about the Low Carbon Accelerator. We're super excited. We're also super excited to be partnered with Climate Salad on this program. So thank you very much, and off to the pitches.
Okay, so one of the things we do with these showcases is, even though you want to hear lots about these businesses and really understand them, part of the goal of giving back that hope and that penchant for action again is to hear lots of different businesses. So instead of doing a few 10-minute pitches, we want to do as many 1-minute pitches as possible to hear there are people solving different parts of the equation, different parts of the problem in different ways, and it also maximizes the chance of finding a company at least that you identify with, may want to work with, be a customer, be an investor. So we're going to have lots of companies here. We're going to go to the spreadsheet now. And what we want to hear from each company, it's under a minute. We just want to hear your name, the name of the company, what does it do, and potentially like either big news or an ask. Like how can people in this room help you? How can they help you? And we're going to capture all the details to make sure that we've got we can follow them up afterwards. We're going to go in this order. And Olivia's going to add. So if anyone is pitching, come down and stand over here, please. Up first, we have David from Air Connect. So we're going to stand right on the tee, David. Hold it to your chin. Give us a good, strong minute.
Okay, everyone. Woo! David Jones from Air Connect. I was told 30 seconds, so it's condensed.
You're right.
Everyone, stick your hand up if you like cool air on a hot day. Guess what? We're all contributing to global warming. My company can't change human behaviour, but we can certainly reduce the impact that the buildings are having on the environment through better managed HVAC. So 80% of Australia's and the US office buildings are in the mid-tier space, so they rarely have automation or any kind of smarts to control them. So a lot of energy is wasted. And I see it every day in my air conditioning contracting life, which is why we had the startup, started the startup 4 years ago. So it makes sense to start with HVAC, because its energy intensity is very high, and the equipment by nature, its energy productivity is relatively low. So there's a lot of low-hanging fruit there. We use machine learning to manage the balance between demand on the grid, consumption, and where renewables permits, we can feed some of our excess energy back into the grid. So we come with
3 seconds, Dave.
Sorry, we've come a fair way. This isn't intimidating at all. So we've come a fair way. We've got a MVP we'll hit in October. We've got a pilot trial going with the local government, two buildings that's well underway. We come here today for an ask. We're not shy. We're looking for $5 million. And what else have I got to say?
That's it. That sounds good. Oh, thank you, David. Next, Katrina from Civic Ledger. Do we have Katrina here? Oh, Katrina, I can hear her. Yeah, you're second. We've already had somebody. Yeah. On the tee. Mic to the chin. Got a minute.
Thanks. Okay, ready? Okay, what if...
30 seconds.
Okay, here we go. What if the fight over water turns to war? To solve the problem of global water security, we need to put a price on water. Then we can measure and report on its true value. My name is Katrina from Civic Ledger, Australia's Blockchain Company of the Year. My solution, Water Ledger, is the next generation water markets powered by blockchain technology, so we can actually provide indisputable accountability between the water we use, the water we share, and the water we have. We're global. We're in Australia, we're in the US, and we're in South Africa. In California, we're helping Common Good Water solve the problem by building water conservation credit markets to incentivize alfalfa farmers to use less water and help corporates become water positive. And we're building a valuable company. Our ask is we're looking for $1 million convertible note to be exchanged for equity when we do our funding round in 12 months' time. Thank you.
Fantastic, Katrina. Thank you. Up next, Dominic from Volta. Dominic, on the tee, mic to the chin.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for coming. My name's Dominic from Volta. Not many people know this, but only around 5% of lithium batteries are recycled worldwide. So we're on track to produce around 2 million tonnes of battery waste before 2030. We're all moving to batteries, but at Volta we believe there's potentially a better way and we can attack this in a circular way. Volta has produced intellectual property around battery casing technology. We believe that the packaging of batteries has a large role to play in the circularity of batteries. They make for second life solutions, cell level repair, and cell level recycling. So we can reverse the trajectory of battery waste, essentially. We're doing it all here in Brisbane, We've got a battery assembly facility where we're setting up in Brisbane, just in Windsor. I'm here to talk to anyone who wants to use batteries. If you want to use batteries that compete on the global stage as far as circularity, come and see me. If you think that that's not such a big issue, maybe give us a pass. Thanks.
Thanks, Dominic. Camille from Bloom.
Hi, everyone. My name is Camille. I'm the founder of Bloom Impact Investing. For a long time, investing in clean tech and clean energy projects like solar farm and wind farm has been restricted to wealthy, sophisticated investors. At Bloom, we think everyone should be able to invest and benefit from the clean energy transition. We have created a simple investing platform allowing you to invest in impactful climate solutions. We already have 1.3 million under management. We've launched 3 months ago. My ask today, we are raising $2 million. We already have 1 million committed. We have our lead. Come and talk to me after the event and jump on the platform, get invested.
Happy customer.
Nick is a customer.
I'm a customer. Thank you, Kimmy. Up next, Kian from Sustainable Choice. Woo!
Hi, my name is Kian Tracy. I'm the founder and CEO of Sustainable Choice. We are a browser-based web platform that houses a connected ecosystem of business sustainability profiles because business sustainability information is complex, it's convoluted, and it's very hard to find because businesses are terrified to communicate too much about their sustainability initiatives for fear of backlash and accusations of greenwashing. So we built a threat-free environment for businesses to communicate their sustainability journey and to do their own self-reporting of their progress and their impact. We've got 65 customers on board at the moment and we're growing every day. We're here to meet other climate technologies because we want to work with you, integrate you onto our platform and work with the community to facilitate a better world.
Fantastic. Up next, Sarah from Leakstar. Sarah from Leakstar, woo!
Drought is the most pervasive climate challenge facing Australia. Despite this, 30% of water is lost due to pipeline leaks and bursts. At Leakstar, we've developed an IoT condition monitoring solution for water utilities that identifies the location of pipeline leaks, bursts, and transients remotely. We've got a contract with Urban Utilities and we're looking to raise $700,000 to complete the design for manufacture. Interested to chat to anybody who is interested in what we're doing to learn more about ourselves and more about yourselves.
Thank you, Sarah. Up next, Sean from Power Lake.
Hello. Woo.
On the tee. We need you on the tee because people are watching from home.
I'm Sean.
So investors with lots of money.
I'm here representing Power Lake. Basically, what we do is we make sure that things that use energy actually use energy during the cheapest and greenest times. So it's pretty simple. what we're mostly looking for is customers and users. So if you pay wholesale rates for electricity, then hit us up. And if you just want to use more green energy, then give our app a shot. It's free.
So is it residential or commercial? Both?
Both.
Both? Fantastic. Yeah. And you're after lots of customers. So customers, how many customers you got so far?
Users are somewhere around 10.
10? Woohoo! Yeah. He's going to walk away with at least 11 tonight. So fantastic. Cool. Thanks, Sean. Fantastic. Up next, we have Alexander from Zero Fins. Woo!
Please raise your hand if you're a surfer or have tried surfing recently. That's a great number, thank you. Each one of you is one of 35 million surfers worldwide. And you may know that the ecological footprint of a surfer is higher than the average person. Zero Fins reduces carbon emissions by 95%. Hi. My name is Alexandra Satzinger, and I'm the co-founder of Zero Fins. We're making world's first high-performance surfboard fins made from 100% bio-based and renewable materials here in Australia. Imagine you lose one of these fins in the ocean, and it's going to start biodegrading after only 2 years. Safe for all creatures. With the environmental movement and our oceans drowning in plastic, we believe together we can create a more sustainable surfing industry. Sierra Fins is looking for advisory and investment. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Up next, Craig from Everledger. Craig.
Thank you. In the rush to an electrified world as we decarbonize, we actually need to mine more. If we're going to mine more for lithium, cobalt, vanadium, we've got to turn them into circular assets. Know your object is what Everledger is all about. I'm not here to pitch for funding tonight, but I am here to pitch for our company. And if you're an inquisitive mind and curious about changing the world, we have a number of roles open, so come and talk to me afterwards.
Fantastic, thank you. David, Defining Future Solutions.
David Small, Defining Future Solutions. Our vision is all things safety. Our first foray is a combined light and smoke detector, further reducing our carbon footprint with additional fire safety protection options for building occupants and first responder firefighters. There is no other product like ours in the world. We have patents in 6 countries, and we have been just reviewed by 2 peak fire safety organisations in Australia that it can propel building safety into the next decade. Seeking $2 million tonight, $50,000 initially for our electronics engineers, MET, to conduct the Australian standards compliance due diligence. Thank you.
Thank you, David. Callum from Tidalmaster. Thanks, Callum.
Oh, good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
On the tee, Callum. We need tobacco.
On the tee.
People are watching at home.
Oh, easy. Sorry.
You're right. All good.
Callum from Tidalmaster. We've basically managed to harvest energy from photons and from the wind, and finally we're blowing it out of the water by harvesting the tide. And our unique invention basically can harvest the power of the tide in both directions. It works in low, medium, and high flow tides as well as rivers, and that's where 90% of the world's population is effectively within, you know, 10 k's of a river or the coastline. So we're hoping to turn around and talk to investors tonight about getting our product through its initial prototyping phase and into the real world testing phase. Thanks very much.
Woo! Tim from Essential WES.
Thanks, Mick. Hey, it's Tim from Essential here. Thank you. We are manufacturing the air battery. So what is an air battery? It lasts twice as long as lithium ion without the rare earth metals, doesn't overheat, but the kicker is that it generates clean water. So up to 5,000 litres of water from a 1 megawatt hour system. We are interested in chatting with investors who are interested in this connection between energy storage and water production, especially in water scarce environments, and the need for community batteries. Thank you.
Thanks, Tim. Ash from Monte Compost.
Hi.
She's got props. Woohoo!
So recycling 100% of our organic waste back into our soil could cut nearly 25% of total global emissions. Composting is the easiest way and the best way to do this, but it's really inefficient. So I started Monte Compost Go to fix that with this compost monitoring device and our mobile analysis system. So I want people here tonight to subscribe, to follow us, to download our app, to buy a monitor, and to join our organics recycling revolution.
I'll take two.
I can give you a discount. Yeah. Hit me up for discounts, everyone.
2 worm farms. Greg from Wildfire Energy.
Hi. Greg. My name's Greg Perkins, co-founder and CEO of Wildfire Energy. And at Wildfire Energy, our vision is to eliminate landfill and turn waste into renewable energy products such as electricity, heat and hydrogen, and doing that with a carbon negative footprint. We've got a pilot plant here in Brisbane, and a big shout out to Advanced Queensland who have supported us to date. We're working with corporates such as Hitachi in Japan to take food waste, CSIRO and GRDC on agri-waste, and other companies like Brisbane City Council. Our big news is we've just secured a first customer who will build a first commercial unit, a $10 million investment.
Yay, customers!
And we're raising tonight. We're looking for $2 million. I've got $1.2 million committed, so I'm looking for investors who really want to come on this journey and solve our landfill waste problems. Thank you.
Excellent. There's a whole range of investment opportunities between $1 million and $10 million. There's something for everybody here. So, Brian from EarthTech. Brian.
Hi.
On the tee.
Are we on? I'm Brian from EarthTech. Thanks for taking the wind out of my sails there. Connect with some pain for a minute. If there's impact investors here, I'm looking at a few of them. You know what it's like, how much money you're spending trying to find deals. For the entrepreneurs here, and I'm looking at a few of you as well that I've known through my journey of 3 years, it hurts raising capital instead of focusing on making impact. And so what we tried to do with a solution using decision intelligence is the EarthTech platform, trying to make that connection between innovators and investors smart and quick. So jump on earthtech.app and check it out. Love to speak to some impact investors. Thanks.
Thank you. Awesome. Jeremy from Maceo. Jeremy, come on down.
The problem we have in the world right now is that we have hundreds of thousands of companies progressing the sustainable development goals and officially reporting ESG compliance. But we need millions of companies to do this. Maceo acts like an operating system to enable companies to aggregate complex ESG and sustainability information and share that with all their stakeholders in real time. We also help companies showcase the good work they're doing through Maceo Tile. Now, we're very fortunate. We've just closed out our oversubscribed seed round. We're now part of KPMG High Growth Ventures, and we're taking on the world. Thank you.
Woohoo! Thanks, Jeremy. Up next, Tarith.
Hi, everyone. I'm Charlie Tratnaika from University of the Sunshine Coast. I'm an academic and a researcher, and our research at the moment looks into utilizing small-scale green hydrogen systems to make agricultural and food processing systems more sustainable. So today, we are looking at securing more funding for our research and to expand our research and industry partnerships.
Fantastic, thank you. Mitchell. Mitchell from Catalyst.
Yep. Thanks, Mike. Hi, Mitch from Catalyst here. So the problem, environmental markets like carbon are complicated, expensive, and opaque. They don't really serve the needs of their users. Using digital measurement verification and reporting technology, Catalyst is helping to actually accelerate the rollout of those markets. And increase end-user engagement. We're here having shown early product market fit, and we're seeking to raise up to $2 million to help product development and accelerate client acquisition. Thank you.
Awesome. Cliff. Cliff from Sustainable Food at Home.
Hi, everybody. My name's Cliff Benz, and I'm the founder of Sustainable Food at Home. And basically, we're on a mission to help feed the world and heal our soils. And we're doing that in a couple of ways. We've got unique technology basically to process your food waste within your home or within 24 to 48 hours, and we turn that product into a early stage compost or natural fertilizer basically. It's a 90% waste reduction also in that 24 hours, and unlike other technologies, it actually, you know, is not a dried food waste. It is a product you can put on your soils, as well as we've got some grow at home gardens. You can use that product in your gardens and grow food at home as well. So we're about to commercialize our technology fully, and we've just opened our seed round. So anyone who's interested, there's a video playing, and come and see me in the room.
Fantastic, thank you. Tim from Ocean Impact.
Hi everyone, Tim Silverwood, co-founder of Ocean Impact Organization, here with my co-founder Nick Shirelli. Look, we're in a startup accelerator and innovation ecosystem aggregator for startups working on solutions to improve ocean health. And we do this by running a range of innovation programs from ideation, accelerator program, and our big one at the moment, which is the Ocean Impact Pitch Fest, $50,000 cash prize for the first placed entry. We also have a climate division We understand the nexus between ocean and climate is so strong. Last year's PitchFest winner was SeaForest, the Tasmanian startup working to reduce methane emissions from livestock through Asparagopsis seaweed. Can't wait to meet more of you tonight.
Woo! Well, that's a pretty high bar with SeaForest. That's awesome. Natalie.
Arte assists companies to transition to net zero through our time cost efficient, science-based, and actionable digital platform. We also provide an automated report that enables organizations to disclose their climate-related risks to regulators, investors, and other stakeholders. I am Natalie, CEO and co-founder of Arte, and I am looking for introductions to potential customers in the mining sector, collaborators, and also open to investors.
Natalie, thank you. Victoria.
Hi. There are a lot of great businesses here tonight, but I have to say there's one thing they're all missing, and that's me. That's right. I'm not here pitching as a business. I'm pitching as an individual. My name is Victoria, and I have a Master's of Environmental Health Science, and I have the unique ability of understanding climate science and being able to commercialize it in a better, faster, and more sustainable way. I'm asking to just have connections, really, industry connections, and if anybody could just go to climatevic.com and shoot me a message on LinkedIn. Love to
Fantastic,
hear from you.
Fantastic, Victoria. I don't think there's going to be any shortage of offers for you by the end of tonight. There's lots of good companies here that need good people. Andy.
Hi, everybody. I'm Andy Hill, founder of Planet Price. Planet Price is an algorithm that calculates the real cost of materials and products. We help large organizations understand their supply chain by expressing the environmental and social impacts in monetary terms. We don't just look at CO2, we also look at land, water, ecotoxicity, human health, and a variety of other indicators. We've been going for beta testing for 9 months, just about to launch internationally, and looking for customers interested in analyzing their scope 3. Thank you.
Amazing, thank you. James from Sober.
Hello, my name's James from the Good Beer Company, and why is a beer company here pitching at a tech event? Well, you're drinking the beer. Hands up if you've tried Sober this evening. Hands up if you're, like me, a Sober co-owner and you invested in their virtual crowdfund campaign to raise a million dollars for the first non-alcoholic craft brew, which is going to be brewed here in Queensland, which is really exciting. That's happening as I speak. The reason I'm here from the Good Beer Co. is we're collaborating with Sober, and I'm really proud that we're launching a beer called Tropical Lager Correlation, which is funding the Sea Women of the Great Barrier Reef, which is a project that's training Aboriginal Torres Strait Islander women in marine biology to complement their First Nations science and knowledge. And that's a brilliant program that if you drink Tropical Lager Correlation, I can't even say it, Correlation, you will be funding that project. You'll be drinking beer for the reef from the Good Beer Co. and Sober. We're going to put a code up on the screen. You can go to Sober, look for Clinton, look for James on LinkedIn, and we will bug you and we'll make sure that you support our possible campaign launching on Monday. Thank you.
Keep drinking, everybody. Oh, we need the mic. Thank you. Liz. Woo!
Liz from Avoda Global. We are a sustainable and ethical garment manufacturer, providing trafficking survivors in Cambodia with training and safe employment. We make everything from sportswear to slow fashion. What do we have to do with climate tech? The textile industry is one of the worst polluters. 800,000 tons of textile waste goes to landfill in Australia every single year. The take, make, discard model is not ethical for workers, nor is it sustainable for the planet. We are creating a network of small, digitally enabled sewing hubs, adopting sustainable practices. We've raised $275,000 in seed funding to date to set up our Brisbane Product Development Center. And we are seeking Series A around $2 million so that we can scale, because we have close to $1 million in prospective orders to deliver over the next 12 months from 3 customers only. So this raise will enable us to deliver those orders and to scale our large customer base beyond those three. Thank you.
Thank you, Liz. Awesome. Amazing. Gavin from Engineer Fusion.
Hi, I'm Gavin Keeley. I'm the CEO and founder of Engineer Fusion. And we're a group of computer scientists and engineers who believe there's a better way to feed the world. So we've come together to actually form a project that starts by turning human waste into human food. And we do that by starting with municipal wastewater, which is what all of you produce every time you flush the toilet. And we're actually going to have a fish farm that actually uses the waste product from those facilities. But we don't stop there. The nutrient-rich water from the fish farm actually feeds a hydroponic facility that then grows leafy vegetables. All of those things require a lot of power, so we've got an on-site solar farm. The byproducts of the hydroponics actually produces fresh water, which feeds the hydrogen facility, and all the green hydrogen facilities have a waste product. It's called oxygen. We pipe that back into the fish farm and actually reduce the cost of that production. So we're already working with a whole group of people showcasing technology here in Queensland. So if you want to be part of the project, contact me. And let's actually prove that we can actually feed the world ethically and effectively.
Fantastic. Amazing. Phil of AidHub.
G'day. Imagine a platform, a global SaaS platform, where all of you could accelerate your contributions to the SDG, but in such a way you grow trust with investors, you program manage what you're delivering, and you've got actual KPIs you can share with your peers. But more importantly, what if all of us could collaborate to contribute to the Olympics 2032 environmentally sustainable goals and show we can share that with the world? My name's Phil Nyson. I'm an investor and director of AidHub, an Australian and Indonesian global SaaS platform. But my purpose is not only for return on capital, but to grow my knowledge and to grow my communities with you. I've learned, though, there's an SDG gap between what we want to do and talking about doing and what we can actually measure and deliver. We need help, and AidHub is that global platform so you can bring your knowledge into one place so we can all help each other succeed. What we're looking for is partners with that SDG data and the systems to work with us and to investors to close out our last 200K. We're here to make impact count. Thank you.
Thank you. Teresa. So many fans out there. On the tee, Teresa. We need you on the tee for the crowd at home. They need to hear you.
Hi. We replace harmful and carbon-intensive petrochemicals with renewable pine chemicals. We use only steam and natural solvents to produce rosin and turpentine, which could be used in everyday products. We've just relisted on the ASX, so if you'd like to join us in decarbonizing the chemical industry, you can buy some shares. Thanks.
Amazing. Wow.
Oh, Teresa.
Teresa. So she skipped the seed and Series A. She got straight to the stock exchange. That's fantastic. And up next, Michael from Fable. Hey, Michael.
Thanks, Mick. Michael from Fable. Animal agriculture is responsible for 14.5% of global greenhouse gas emissions. And our goal is to end that by helping end industrial animal agriculture by making delicious meaty food out of mushrooms to help you all reduce meat consumption. So my ask tonight is to try our products. We're the Fable shredded mushrooms at Guzman and Gomez, and we've put some of those on for you all tonight so you can enjoy our Fable burritos. We're on the menu at Grilled, our Fable meaty mushroom burgers. You can try us at, thank you, Charlotte, yeah. Nice modeling. Ribs and burgers, you can try our burgers there. You can buy our product in retail at Harris Farm in West End, and on the menu at lots of other great restaurants. So for every Fable shredded mushroom burrito you eat at Guzman and Gomez, you save 6.5 kilograms of carbon emissions as compared with beef. So please enjoy tonight.
Thank you, Michael. And thanks for some food as well.
Thank you.
Wow, huh? Pretty impressive. Who's impressed by all those companies? I hope you got a glimpse of what we aim to do, which is to give you that sense that there's a lot of people with a lot of passion and a lot of knowledge solving a broad range of problems. There's not going to be one solution. You see, some of those companies really overlap with each other. We can't just pursue one. This is why Climate Salad, we're looking to support 1,000 companies by 2030 because they all need a chance to build a product, go get customers, and go solve some of these big global problems. So the diversity there was incredible in terms of the breadth of companies and stages, and there's lots of companies there to help that you can go and help and participate. You don't have to be an investor in all of them. They just all need more people around them who are passionate about solving these problems. So if nothing else tonight other than drinking more sober to help the Great Barrier Reef, go and find some companies that you connect with that you believe in, grab the teams and find a way to actually participate and make an impact. It's really possible and it's actually really, really important that we do that. So thank you so much. And another big round of applause for all those companies pitching. So really, really impressive and absolutely totally what I'd say to Sarah and the team here. You have a significant amount of base to be able to build an incredible climate tech industry here. You talked about those unique assets and the opportunity here for Queensland. Incredible. A huge entire ecosystem. Lots of jobs, lots of companies, lots of solutions, and lots of inspiration, I think. So absolutely plenty of potential there. So that was great to see. Thank you so much. Have I got my clicker working yet? Okay. Oh, we got a lucky door prize from Bloom Impact Investing. Is the team for Bloom here? We got ready to pick it. Ready.
Thank you for everyone who participated in the competition, and the winner is Lana Stark.
Lana, is Lana here? Yay, winner! $1 million. No, not $1 million.
Just a $500 investment starter pack with Bloom. So please find me after this, and we can talk about how that prize will be activated.
Amazing. And my Bloom investment's already going up, so you know. It's a fantastic. That's amazing. Thank you, Bloom. I really appreciate you coming along. And you know, there's companies like Fable and Bloom that have been involved in Climate Salad for a long time. And one of the big things that they both echo is participation. So this is not an ecosystem where you sit there and wait for someone to write your checks. It's an ecosystem where we expect everyone to participate, partners at all levels and all companies. This is absolutely one of the most collaborative and positive ecosystems I've ever been a part of. And I really welcome you to come and join Climate Salad and help us keep growing this. Some more thank yous. Massive thank you to the Office of Queensland Chief Entrepreneur. A round of applause for them and the team here putting that on today. Thank you so much. It might seem like you go to Humanitix, you put your name in, you turn up and you eat some nice food and have some drinks. But the team there that has supported the vision of making this and the belief that doing something like tonight is the kickstart of a big industry is absolutely an enormous credit to them. So I really, really appreciate their support from them, and I really want to make sure we're back really regularly and driving this community to as big as potential as possible. So thank you to the team there, Sarah and the team. Our partners as well, a number of them here tonight, go and see them, track them down. Again, we don't tell them to throw their logo on the page. We tell them to turn up and participate. And that's absolutely critical for that. So thank you to them. Fable, Sober, Hawks, Pakarama and Heaps Normal, thank you so much for your support and providing some of the amazing food and drinks we're having tonight. And that's it from us. Go and meet some good people. That's why you're here. Make some good connections. Give us some feedback. Thank you so much for coming.